Hi all. Today we will discuss the poem Ode to a Nightingale by John Keats. John Keats, a poet of the Romantic era, composed this poem in 1890. It was written a few months after the death of his brother, Tom Keats. He published the ode in 1820 in the collection entitled Lamia Isabella, The Eve of St. Agnes and Other Poems. Soon after his brother's death, Keats spent some time with his friend, Charles Brown, at Hampstead. The poem was inspired by the song of a nightingale, which the poet heard in the gardens of his friend. The poem is arranged into 8 stanzas, each of 10 lines. The meter used in each line of every stanza is iambic pentameter, except for the 8th line of each stanza, which is written in iambic trimeter. Each stanza follows the rhyme scheme ABAB, CDE, CDE. In stanza 1, Keats describes the effect of the song of the nightingale upon his mind. His senses became numb and dull due to the excess feelings of joy in the song of the nightingale. The poet begins the poem expressing how his heart aches as if he is poisoned or is drugged. He feels he had drunk hemlock or consumed drug opium and sunk into the lethe. Hemlock is a medicinal sedative plant with poisonous qualities. The poet feels exactly like a person who has drunk hemlock. In Greek mythology, Lethe, a river which all souls had to cross after death before reaching the underworld. It's a river of forgetfulness. Listening to the bird song, the poet has forgotten his pain and misery as if he had crossed the Lethe river. The nightingale is referred to light-winged dryad of the trees. Dryads were nymphs who inhabited the woods and trees. It seems to him that he is listening to the song of a wood nymph. The song glorifies the summer season and the nightingale is singing in full-throated ease. In the second stanza, the poet expresses his desire for some wine. It would enable him to leave the world and fade away with the bird. The song of the bird creates in him a desire for draught of vintage or wine cooled for ages under the earth. Wine reminds him of Flora, the Roman mythical goddess of lovers and the festivities held in honor of her. He longs for wine of special quality from warm southern countries. The poet wants to enjoy a drink from the fountain of Hippocrene, the blushful Hippocrene. Hippocrene refers to the fountain of the muses in Greek mythology who inspire poetry. It sprang from Mount Helicon when struck by the winged horse Pegasus. It is referred blushful because the poet longs for a beaker full of red wine. This wine has beaded bubbles winging at the brim. The word winging here means sparkling. Even the mouth of the beaker may be stained with red color of the wine. The poet feels that the wine will inspire him like the Hippocrene, which have the power of poetic inspiration. With the help of wine, he wants to fade far away into the world of the nightingale, where it sings joyfully. In stanza 3, the poet wishes to forget the weariness, the fever and fret of life and to become one with the bird and its happy world. Here in this world, people sit and hear each other groan. Palsy attacks the old and the young die of consumption. In these lines, the poet may be thinking of his brother Tom's death. Keats nursed his brother who was suffering from consumption. The poet himself is afflicted by tuberculosis and is living in the shadow of death. He is reminded of the tragedy of human life. All those things which we value most, youth, beauty and love, are subject to disease and decay. So he wants to escape from this world of sorrow and live with the nightingale forever. In stanza 4, the poet chooses poetic imagination to reach the ideal world of nightingale. To Keats, the intoxication caused by poetry is superior to that of wine. The poet decides to join the bird on the viewless wings of poesy, that is, on the invisible wings of imagination, and rejects the idea of being charioted by Bacchus and his parts. Bacchus is the Roman god of wine. Parts means leopards. The chariot of Bacchus is drawn by leopards. The poet rejects wine and turns to poetry to escape into the enchanted world of the nightingale. But reason prevents him from forgetting this world. In his powerful imagination, the poet is already with the bird in the forest. He says, "Tender is the night. Night has not advanced, and Queen Moon sits on her throne surrounded by the stars. Even though the moon shines in the sky above, the leafy branches of the trees shut out the light and it is dark below. However, the moonlight peeps in through the moss-covered trees and brightens the shades. Stanza 5 is rich with a sensuous expression of color, scent and touch. The poet imagines himself sitting with the nightingale in the forest. The place is dark. He cannot see the flowers that blossom all around him. From the fragrance emanating from the flowers, he can guess what flowers are at his feet. The forest is full of the grass, the thicket, the white hawthorns, the pastoral eglantine, violets and the musk rose. The atmosphere is filled with the sweet fragrance of flowers, and the buzzing bees are attracted by its fragrance. In stanza 6, the poet is still listening to the music of the nightingale. The poet reaches at the peak of happiness. The ecstasy of the moment makes him crave for death. The poet confesses that he wishes to die a number of times in the past. He feels that it is the best time for him to die because he can die enjoying the music of the bird. It will be a painless death for him. Even after his death, the bird will continue its ecstatic music. In stanza 7, the poet's mortality is contrasted with the immortality of the bird song. The poet says that the music of the bird is immortal. In the past also, the nightingale's music delighted everyone. The same song was heard in ancient times by emperor and clown. Perhaps the same music entered the sad heart of Ruth when she was standing alone in the cornfield in a foreign country and comforted her. Ruth is a character in the Bible. After her husband's death, she went with her mother-in-law, Naomi, to a land of strangers. It is the same song which cast a spell upon the enchanted windows of a castle situated on the shore of a dangerous ocean in fairy lands forlorn. In stanza 8, the music of the nightingale fades. The poet's imagination also breaks. The word forlorn is like the sound of a bell, and it shakes the poet back into the world of reality. As the song of the nightingale becomes more distant, his imagination, which had carried him into the forest, also declines, and the poetic vision fades. He realizes that he is moving back from the region of poetic fantasy to the world of hard reality. He wonders whether he has been listening to a song or he has been merely dreaming. The poem is one of the finest examples of Keats' pictorial quality and his rich sensuousness. It describes Keats' journey into the state of negative capability. That's all for today. Thank you for watching.